That's the hope. That's the hope. For the simple reason that we were very careful when we were designing the NTB strategy to use and to align, I would say, with the philosophy of what are now the Sustainable Development Goals. And so we are in the NTB strategy really adapting the way we have to face tuberculosis, the response to tuberculosis, to the same approach that the Sustainable Development Goals are promoting. And that means, you know, the stewardship of the government, at the same time, the full participation, engagement of the civil society. And this is where we will have to work a lot to really engage more and more. And that's what we have been doing as WHO, for instance, with the meeting just 2 weeks ago in Addis Ababa with the 89 NGOs to really try to engage them. Many of them were unengaged in TB control. Yet they are there in the primary care system, and they're not doing TB. So we are telling them, you need now to participate. It's going to be a whole of society approach. So we are aligned fully with those, the notion of equity, for instance, the notion of gender equity, the notion of human rights. So all of these are elements that the Sustainable Development Goals are pushing very much, are promoting very much. So the new NTB strategy aligns with that, speaks about universal access, universal health coverage, to be actually even more specific, which means universal health coverage means providing the best possible quality of care without impoverishing people, you know, without having them incur catastrophic expenditures. We're speaking about social protection mechanism, because we know that these are the poorest among the poor. And so without the protection, financial protection during the period of treatment, you know, people get poorer than what they are because they lose income, and we know that very well. So all of this is being incorporated now on top of the more technical, say, aspects of TB care, like how you make early diagnosis, how you focus on the vulnerable population, how you provide treatment to everyone without distinction of type of TB or children, adults, you know, everyone has the right to receive that. And also now we are pushing very much the notion of prophylaxis in those populations that are at particular risk, where the potential side effects of the prophylaxis itself is in a way, less important than saving the life of people who are at very high risk. So that is what the new philosophy is speaking about. And finally, the last point is really on research. You know, everyone is talking about innovation in TB control and in TB care. And so without those, we know very well that the trajectory that we have designed won't be reached, because you really need something that will revolutionize, transform the way TB is dealt with. Infection control is an issue that is very serious. It's an issue, first of all, that has not been faced in the majority of low or middle income countries. So when I go around the low middle income countries, I mean, if you go to the United States or Switzerland, you find isolation rooms, you find ultraviolet lights, and so on and so forth. You go to most of the poorer countries, you don't find that at all. So you are lucky when actually you find well-structured facilities, for instance, with good ventilation, with air that can go from one side to another, or they're well exposed to the sun, because we know that these elements, the ventilation, the sun, etc., kill essentially or prevent the transmission of bacilli that cause tuberculosis. But it is absolutely true that this is just occasional in most of the endemic countries for tuberculosis. So it's one of the policies that we are now describing clearly in the second pillar of the new strategy when we speak about bold policies. One of the bold policies, if you look at the narrative there, is actually that of infection control. And so no doubt that the famous episode of Tugel affair you are referring to in KwaZulu-Natal was linked to that. Yes. People were in the same big ward at a certain point, or facility where people on antiretrovirus living with HIV were there. So you have a person with TB, they're particularly vulnerable to get infected and to evolve very rapidly from infection to disease. And this is exactly what happened, and is what is happening probably as we are speaking in 1,000 other facilities around the world. So unless this is really adopted as a serious policy to be undertaken, to be implemented, is going to be difficult. And that requires not just the national program, because it's not the national program. Many times these facilities, as you mentioned, in this case were HIV, so it doesn't depend on TB programs. They have to be, there must be a policy enforcement by making the policy first if there is no policy on infection, and then enforcement by the Minister of Health. It's the highest level there that has to make sure that the hospital infrastructure, the facility, clinic infrastructure are provided with this at least basic element, like, you know, as I say, ventilation and things like that, that can prevent the infection, the transmission of the infection. So it's a major problem, it's a top priority, it's listed very clearly among the bold policy that we need in the system. You know, in one of the other elements of the new strategy is really what we say, map your epidemic. So you have to understand where the people with TB are coming from. This could be geographical, so they may come from the slum area and certainly not the rich part of Mumbai. They come from the slum areas of Mumbai and not the rich part. And that is one thing, but the other is also those type of population, like, for instance, the diabetic population that are particularly susceptible. They have a risk. Once they are infected with TB, without the disease, but infected, their risk of developing the disease is 2.5 times that of a person that does not have diabetes. For HIV, it's 30 plus time, so it's much more, but diabetes is much more frequent than HIV. So we have to really watch that component, especially in middle-income countries, where now the availability of fast food and, you know, not healthy food is now accessible. So people with $1 or $2, they can buy anything that makes them obese, and then you go towards diabetes. You have a situation like this, TB will actually thrive. Same is valid for smoking, which is a big epidemic of tobacco, right, as we know. Same is valid for alcohol abuse, and so on and so forth. So there are these risk factors that are there, and we know very well what they are. And so it's really an issue of health promotion in the end, and looking and targeting the determinants of TB beyond the known, you know, obvious ones like HIV. We have to go beyond that. We have to talk about obesity prevention. We have to talk about diabetes, as of course, linked with obesity. We have to talk about smoking. We have to talk about alcohol abuse, and so on. You have a diabetes clinic, people have to be on the alert, because if someone is coughing too much and not in a not explainable way, then people have to think, this man or woman has 3 times the risk of a non-diabetic. So let me just try to find out if he, perhaps the cough is due to TB. Because if you don't do that, it will take another month or 2 or 3, meanwhile this poor person would have infected another 10 people around her. So this is another issue that is again linked to what we like to call the social determinants, yes, of TB, which is addressed once again in our, yes, pillar number 2. So we are saying alleviate the social determinants or economic determinants of tuberculosis, and probably the most obvious one is what you mentioned, is the poor living conditions. People living in a room like this one, and there are 20 of them, or even think about refugees, yes, migrants, they live under very miserable conditions. So you are in a situation like this, you have these poor people, and one of them happens to have TB, the other 20 will get infection, and many of them perhaps will evolve towards the disease for the simple reason they are, at the same time, they are under stress, they are malnourished, they don't sleep well, their immune system is not capable of containing it. So this has to be really clear, and one thing is to focus on the care part, which means I detect the case as quickly as possible and I cure the case so that we stop the transmission. Another is also at the same time that of you that going to alleviate this social determinants of tuberculosis, which prevents the onset of disease. The incidence decline of tuberculosis is about 1.5% per year, and it has been like that for 10 years. So it's not changing. That's why in the new strategy, what we foresee there is an acceleration of all of these elements, and that requires a lot of commitment, goodwill, and investment. And we can talk separately about how much money is needed. Yes. But these are the investments that are going to be, at a certain point, the solution to tuberculosis. You alleviate poverty, tuberculosis will go away progressively, perhaps slowly, but will go away. At the moment, it is going away at 1.5% per year, which means a couple of centuries before we really can get rid of TB. And so we need to accelerate. The model that has been produced to convince ministers of health to sign off on the new strategy is the following. If we are going down at 1.5% per year, we think that the world can go down at 10% per year in 10 years' time, progressively increasing from 1.5 to 2 to 3 to 4, until by 2025 we get minus 10% per year. Why 10%? Because this is what we saw in Europe at the end of the war, in the 50s and 60s. It was possible there. Europe was not as rich as it is today at the time. Yes, yes. So I can think that that would be not very unlikely, the situation in the BRICS. Yes. That are growing economies, people are becoming, many people at least, are becoming richer. we get the problem of equity there, because some are becoming richer and some other are remaining poor, and that's what we really need to address. But if there is a hope that the sustainable development goals will be reached one day in 2030, then that will have an impact also on the incidence decline. So we hope by 2025 to see a 10% decline in the world. And I'm sure that China and Brazil and even India and Russia can make it to 10%. I just learned that Russia is going down at 10% now. If this is confirmed in the next 3, 4, 5 years, there we have another model, another example that is possible. So by 2025, though, we won't be able, if we reach minus 10% that year, we won't be able to accelerate more than that, because no one has ever demonstrated in any country that possibility. We will need new tools, and that's where research becomes essential. And if we don't invest in research, then it's going to be tough. In the next 10 years, we must optimize the use of everything we have, including prophylaxis, by the way, not just vaccine or the diagnosis and treatment is obvious, but also vaccine, prophylaxis. And in particular, we are insisting on that all the countries should evolve towards what is called universal health coverage and what is called perhaps also financial or social protection of people like those with TB that have chronic disease, because this is long. 6 months if you have MDR-TB, let alone is 24 months, but you know, these people lose their income. These are the poorest among the poor. You remove from them $10 per day or $5 per day, you're done. You're poor the following day. And then we pretend that they go to the clinic to get the drugs, you know, and they cannot survive because they have no food. So there we are. So without this financial protection mechanism, it's not going to be achievable.